Ker Slovenija sodi med tiste dežele in jih je kar nekaj v Evropski uniji, kjer se nikoli nismo šli boja proti drogam in uporaba drog, posest za lastno uporabo, že od konca 90-ih let pri nas ni kriminalizirana. Kaj to pomeni? Da če ti poseduješ drogo in je ta za lastno uporabo, je to prekršek, ne pa kazenski pregon. Kar pomeni, da ne greš v register in če zelo poenostavim, ko te vprašajo, ali ste bili kdaj v kazenskem postopku, ne rečeš, sem bil, ampak si imel samo prekršek, tako kot recimo napačno parkiranje. In to je bistvena razlika, zato da ne kriminaliziramo teh ljudi, ki te droge uporabljajo.
Pregon kaznivih dejanj, povezanih s konopljo, tudi v konkretnih primerih Slovenijo izjemno veliko stane. Stane v tem, da se, bomo rekli po domače, celoten sistem zavrti za to, da se nekoga obsodi na pogojno obsodbo, zato ker je na mogoče celo za zdravstvene ali pa tudi rekreativne namene gojil nekaj sadik konoplje na svojem balkonu. To so izjemni stroški.
Šlo je v bistvu zato, da sem poskušal pozdraviti domače z prepovedano rastlino konopljo. Na črnem trgu nisem nikjer mogel dobiti smole in enostavno sem želel sam nekaj eksperimentirati in sam narediti. Pa sem mi prišel po želji in te je bilo to. Za tega sem bil obsojen. Kot prvo je prišel do razpada družine. Psihični pritiski so bili ogromni.
Ne more si vsak tega privoščiti. Zaradi tega smo se tudi mi doma odločili za samo oskrbo, ki pa nam je pol na konc koncev prinesla kriminalisti na doma. Ne? Tako da smo trenutno še vedno v postopku in sigurno je to stres za bolnika in vse celotno okolico, ne? Ki... Tako da takih stvari si bolnik ne sme, ne more privoščiti, ker enostavno potrebuje moč za to, da se spopade z boleznjo.
Semena, velikih je ostali in ptiči so raznosili in se je kar na dvorišču razrastali okrog. Tri dni nazaj so mi pa policisti požel tisto konopljo, ki se ptiči že itak pojedal.
Ko sem postal bolnik za eno kronično črevesno boleznjo in sem začel takrat uporabljati konopljo in mi je konoplja zelo pomagala. Potem sem bil v naslednjih letih zaradi tega preganjan in sem imel občutek, da se mi godi osebna krivica.
Samo oskrba za to se pa bojiš, mislim, to je prepovedano.
V vsaki državi imajo sistem, kjer uvrščajo zdravila, ki so uporabili v tisti državi na nek način, ki zagotavlja, da so ta zdravila za ljudi varna, da so kakovostna in da dejansko učinkujejo. In prav je tako, ker kam pa pridemo, da bi recimo ponujali neke substance skozi zdravstveni sistem, za katere ne bi vedli, ali so učinkovite, ali niso, ali so kakovostne in morda celo škodijo bolj kot zdravi.
Cannabis is used for treatment in several countries already, and these countries have very good results. I was for many seminars. Believe me, we do it even when we travel and lose time which we can sacrifice for science. We do it free of charge because we are happy to help the people. Because when I see patients which were crippled and physicians couldn't help them sometime, and cannabis helped them, so it looks like miracle, you know. So why to protect patients from this medicine which can help them?
You know, we have to have randomized controlled trials. We want the most rigorous studies to eliminate any human bias, but you can't ignore the mountain of anecdotal evidence, whether it's a case report, case series, observational studies that are confirming that this plant has a tremendous therapeutic potential that patients are mining on their own. The patients are discovering this, teaching each other how to use it. If the government truly cared about its citizens, they would be listening to the patients and they would be launching study after study right now to understand more about how this plant works and how patients are responding so that we can figure out how to harness even more potential of the plant.
And I think it's very important for politicians and people in control, law enforcement, etc., to understand that there's something very special about marijuana that's different from all others, and it really should not be considered a drug, it should be considered a food. Because when we don't have proper nutrition, we have consequences. Nobody knew there was an endocannabinoid system until 1988. And it wasn't until the next decade, over the next decade, that the scientific foundation was laid for the expansion and the explosion that has occurred over the past few years, now that we understand that the endocannabinoid system regulates everything in our body from conception till death. Politicians have to understand that what I'm just telling you is absolutely true. It's not going to ever go away. This is reality, and now science has discovered this reality, and we can't erase the truth.
Being a scientist and looking at the scientific medical literature, since the discovery of the receptor, there's been an absolute explosion in the amount of scientific research behind the endocannabinoid system.
Reasons to doctors to participate in educational programs to explain them that it's probably going to be part of our regular medicine armamentarium. And this is why doctors should be understand that they will be questioned by their patients. They should be ready to answer the question, not to say it is a drug for abuse, it is a dangerous drug. Now it is unacceptable, and doctor is going to understand it.
I would say, how much evidence do you need? Because there is thousands and thousands of scientific papers where the scientists are telling us that this is the result. So I always say to the government, well, you pay the scientists to do the research. Then when they publish the paper, well, if you don't believe what they're publishing, then you're saying that the scientist is telling lies. You know, we have so much evidence.
It's hard to believe it could be even bigger. But, yeah. So that's the tumor there.
Okay.
Yeah. And then it took probably a couple of months of every day using the treatment. I mean, that's when it's starting to decay. It's pretty, pretty yucky.
Okay.
And then you can see, really, from there on, you can see that it's not here.
Zaenkrat še je prepovedana droga. Vsi pravijo, da je droga, ampak ne, to je zdravilo za mene. Najbolj pomembno zdravilo, ko ga res nujno rabi. Kemoterapija me dobesedno glavo raztrgalo naenkrat. 23 dni v komi, pol pa vedno boljše je bilo, če sem uporabljal konoplo.
Srečo v nesreči, če se lahko izrazil, sem imela, da sem res že prej raziskovala samo konoplo, da sem v bistvu, ko sem dobila patohistološki izvid, ki je pokazal na glioblaston, to je maligen tumor, četrta stopnja, nekje povprečne dobra preživetja pa od 14 do 16 mesecev.
Jaz sem prepričana, da Slovenija ne bo zadnja država, ki bo stvari spreminjala, ampak bo ena med prvimi, kot je to vedno tudi bilo. Sem pa pojasnila, zakaj medicinska konoplja ni danes tukaj. Bo tist moment, ko jo bo nekdo, mislim, medicinska konoplja oziroma kanabinoidi, gre za ta zdravila. Ne? Tukaj ne bi smel biti zadržkov.
Zdravnik v Sloveniji lahko trenutno predpiše sintetično obliko THC na bel recept. Lahko predpiše CBD, za katerega ni točno jasno, ali sintetski ali rastlinski, to, ker pač lekarne imajo dostop do njega. In po naši zakonodaji lahko načeloma predpiše tudi cvetove iz konoplje, vendar to v praksi se ne dogaja, zato ker ni dobavitelja oziroma pač te poti niso urejene. V lekarnah tega ni, torej zdravnik tudi, če predpiše, pacient tega ne dobi. In seveda to je z veliki diametralnim nasprotjem s tem, ker praksa pa znanost potrjuje, da je potrebno. Ne? Torej, tu imamo eno molekulo ali THC ali CBD iz 1064 molekul, ki jih je v rastlini na voljo. To delovanje ni primerljivo z celotnim izvlečkom rastline. In izkušnje in delovanje na naše telo je popolnoma drugačno. Ne? To je prvo izhajalo iz prakse, ko se je videlo, da ljudje, ki so dobili predpisane posamezne kanabinoide, so prej slepe prešaltali na celo rastlino, tudi če so zato bili v sivi črni zakonodaji. Ne?
Ker mi se pogovarjamo o medicinski uporabi konoplje, se pa pogovarjamo tudi o legalizaciji konoplje, samo uporabi, pridelovanju za lastno uporabo. In tukaj je treba vedeti, da obstaja neka nevarnost in tudi v ameriških teh državah se že zavedajo in so bile raziskave narejene, ki ugotavljajo, da se jim bo za 6% povečala uporaba konoplje te, ki je psihotropna, ki ima take učinke v rekreativne namene pri mladih. In to jih skrbi. Tega se zavedajo in mi pa bomo seveda gledali, kaj se bo zgodilo.
Yeah, so it's interesting you say how much has it changed after legalization. Because Colorado, awesome example, youth has actually declined. If anything, after legalization, no increase whatsoever in youth smoking. So, and the reason for that is because there's dispensaries, there's shops. You go, you show your ID, and if you don't have the proper ID, even if your card is messed up, they're not going to let you buy it. So it's a lot safer than a kid going to some stranger and asking him for pot. It's a lot harder to do that now.
Mm-hmm. Obstaja, bomo rekli, neka hipokrizija v tem, da imamo prepovedano konopljo, ki v družbi nesporno povzroča bistveno manj škode kot recimo alkohol, ki povzroča bistveno širše družbene probleme od družinskega nasilja, smrti v prometu in tako naprej.